by more than 1. So the sensitivity is 1, and I would compute the true answer to that query, which is 4, and I'd add a random sample drawn from a Laplace distribution with scale 2. If I think about another type of query, a count query, which counts the number of nodes with degree I, some degree I, sensitivity of this query is actually 2. So if I add an edge to a graph, again, I change 2 degrees, each by 1. Well, in the worst case, I could have added an edge to 2 degree 5 nodes. Both of those nodes become degree 6. So how many nodes have degree 5 after I add that edge? 2 fewer, because 2 of them now have degree 6. So the sensitivity is 2. And then I add correspondingly more noise to that query answer. So I need to understand the sensitivity of the queries that I'm going to answer under differential privacy. Oftentimes that's not too hard, but it's something you have to prove. You have to think about it and prove this is the sensitivity, worst case change in my query answer over 2 neighboring databases. And then we know how to calibrate the noise for that query. So to a first approximation, what happens is that if we are interested in answering queries that have low sensitivity, then we can add low noise and get accurate answers out. If we want to try to answer high sensitivity queries, we have to add high noise, and we get noisy answers that aren't so useful. So there's one more wrinkle, actually 2 more wrinkles I have to tell you about. If I want to ask more than 1 query of a differentially private interface, I can do that. I can do it interactively, but I'm not going to really talk about interactive querying in this talk. Instead, I'm going to imagine that I bundle a bunch of queries together into a vector of numbers. Imagine it's a vector-valued query. It returns a list of numbers. If I do that, there's an easy way to extend what I had in the last slide to calculate the sensitivity and calibrate the noise. So here's how it works. If I ask a list of degree queries, the degrees of A, B, and C, and I bundle those together as 1 query, then I have to think about the sensitivity of that as a vector, which is the sort of sum of the absolute values in each component, the L1 distance for vectors. So if I ask for the degree of A, B, and C, the sensitivity goes up to 2, because if I add an edge, remember I changed the degree of 2 nodes, and I might have added the edge between A and B, and then A's degree goes up by 1 and B's degree goes up by 1. But I could never change more than 2 degrees by 1, so the sensitivity is 2. So I'll compute the true answer, which might be a vector 141, and then I add independent Laplace noise to each component. That's the slight extension of what was on the last slide. I can answer a set of queries this way. It turns out that the count query sensitivity goes up to 4, but it's independent of the length of that vector, so it's still a constant that's relatively low. Okay, the last wrinkle is that differential privacy, as I've described it, is protecting, it's calibrating the noise to protect the addition or deletion of edges to the graph, single edges. And I've given you enough examples, I think, earlier in the talk to point out that the sensitive information in a social network is not necessarily a single edge. It may be a node's degree or certain patterns of edges that exist that we may want to hide. So what we're working with is a notion that we call K-edge epsilon differential privacy. It requires that the algorithm output be indistinguishable whether or not any set of K-edges is added or removed from the graph. It's a simple extension to the one-edge case. You could argue that for privacy, you would really like to have node epsilon differential privacy. That might be the firmest standard for security, but I think that that is going to destroy a lot of properties of the graph. It's going to introduce too much noise, and K-edge differential privacy can do a pretty good job if you turn K up to numbers that approach the maximum degree in the graph. Okay, so ask me about that later if you want to talk a little bit more about that setup. Okay, so that was differential privacy. It's a technical definition. I had to go through the technical stuff to make our contributions understandable. All right, so now our task is study the degree distribution of a graph, the degree or the degree sequence. The degree sequence is the list of degrees that occur in a graph. Okay, so I look at every node in the graph. Each node has some degree, and I want to look at that list of degrees. It's a basic property that many people, sort of the first thing you look at when you want to understand what's going on with my graph. That is the degree sequence of our toy graph. When graphs are big, we'll look at the degree sequence as the inverse cumulative distribution, which is a graph which shows on the x-axis the different degrees of the graph. And for example, on the left-hand side, you have nearly 100% of the population has a degree greater than zero, and then it goes down to the right. Okay, so is the degree sequence itself really sensitive? Do I have to protect this? Let's take a moment to think about that. You might argue that the degree sequence itself is a kind of summary statistic about the graph, and maybe it's safe to just release exactly the degree sequence. Well, I would argue no, because for one reason, in extreme cases, the degree sequence of a graph could uniquely determine a graph up to isomorphism. So if every node happens to have degree k, then there is only one graph. And if you release that degree sequence, you will have done essentially the same thing as naive anonymization. You will have published an isomorphic copy of the graph. Now, that's unlikely to occur in real graphs, that everyone would have the same degree or that the degree sequence that would uniquely determine a graph, but it's hard to reason about how many different graphs there might be conforming to a degree sequence. In addition, the degree sequence may not be the only statistics that we want to release about a graph. So we want to answer the degree sequence in this framework of differential privacy, and then we could also know how to answer other queries about graphs, and we would still have a sort of integrated privacy guarantee. Okay, so our basic task is estimate the degree sequence accurately under differential privacy. And here are two natural attempts, and they're based on the example queries I showed you when I was explaining differential privacy. We could ask for a vector of numbers, which is just the degree of every node. We have some way of indexing the node. We ask for the degree of each node. The sensitivity of this vector is 2, so I know how to calibrate noise, and the noise will be added will be independent in each component. I could also ask for a slightly different query, which is the frequency of each degree. Okay, that's also a vector of length n, but starting from 0 going to the maximum feasible degree of n minus 1, and it just counts how many individuals have that degree. That has sensitivity which is a little bit higher, but still relatively low, sensitivity of 4. So here's what I get if I apply those techniques and I try to estimate the degree sequence of the ORCID network, a sample network that we played around with. Both of these estimates, the blue line and the green line, are not very good estimates of the black line. I think you'll agree. So what's going on with the blue line, which is the set of F queries, which is the frequency of each degree. In a social network, what happens is that you've got, in ORCID has like on the order of a few million nodes. The maximum degree in most social networks is much lower than N. Because if you think about the social networks that you may participate in all, Facebook has 100 million users, but there aren't many people with degrees higher than a few thousand, okay? So if I sample counts of all the degrees, what I have is this enormous part of the sequence which is asking for how many people have degree 100 million and 100 million minus 1 and all of these. And the answer is 0 in all of these cases, but I'm adding random noise. Sometimes I get a negative number, and I could round that to 0, but sometimes I get a positive number, and then it looks like I have one person in my data set with degree 100 million. In fact, when there's so many of those observations, that it looks like there's a lot of people with really high degrees, and that blue line that you see is measuring that. There, the percentage of the population with degree greater than 500 is still 100. Okay. Now, there's a different problem with the green line, which is the D query, which asks for each person's degree, and that is that there's a lot of common low-degree nodes, and those sometimes get randomly perturbed beneath 0 and get rounded to 0, so there's a lot of zeros. And that's why the green line starts lower than 100%. Okay, so here's our innovation. It seems like a simple trick, but it turns out to be kind of a deeper technique. So instead of asking the D query, I'll compare it to the D query. we ask for the degree of each node. We actually